स्थापकाय च धर्मस्य सर्वधर्मस्वरूपिणे स्थापकाय च धर्मस्य सर्वधर्मस्वरूपिणे अवतारवरिष्ठाय रामकृष्णाय ते नमः। असतो मा सद्गमय तमसो मा ज्योतिर्गमय मृत्योर्मामृत शांति शांति। लेट अस बो डाउन टू श्री रामकृष्ण द एम्बॉडीमेंट ऑफ ऑल रिलीजन्स द सुप्रीम गॉड इनकार्नेट। लेट अस प्रे टू हिम टू लीड अस फ्रॉम द अनरियल टू द रियल टू लीड अस फ्रॉम द डार्कनेस ऑफ इग्नोरेंस to the light of knowledge, to lead us from death to immortality. Today's topic, Guru's grace, vital for spiritual progress. It is very important to know the significance of the Guru's relationship with the disciple and the disciple's relationship with the Guru. So, your spirituality starts with your connection to appropriate spiritual teacher. So, the spiritual teacher plays a very important role in your life. Coming to spiritual life means it is a second birth for you. That means your whole system must be tuned towards spiritual life. And it becomes significant when you have a real guru to help you in spiritual life. So, the important point here is, unless you struggle to enter into the spiritual realm, you will not be able to appreciate the value of Guru in your life. That means you need to turn a bit towards God. You need to have an aspiration for spiritual life. That initial struggle, initial effort must be there on your part. Then everything follows up very clearly. Well, there are
so many categories of teachers. Just like there are number of books to read, ocean of books, what books to read and what not to read. So anything you look into leads to infinity. There is no end for anything. Do you feel end to your desires? Emphatic no. Do you feel satisfaction in the worldly life? Emphatic no. Do you feel real happiness in the life which you are leading in this life of sensuous pursuit? Emphatic no. So, but still people are running and running and running and running. Even though they're exhausted, they still keep running. Because they're simply running without any goal. Running more and more towards the world means getting into more and more suffering. Getting into more and more restlessness. Getting into more and more involvement and entanglement in the world. That means you are being bound firmly into the world. As long as you are in that state, how can you expect any happiness in your life? How can you expect any peace of mind? It is really impossible. So, then you will have to turn towards God. But turning is not so easy. You need something in your life to get a warning. Then only you turn yourself. You need a little shock treatment, a little shock, so that you become aware of the reality. That little shock, that little knocking is essential to everyone. And that knocking will come, that shock will come. You are made to turn towards God because you belong to God. Otherwise, you would not have got any shock, you would not have got any kicks at all. But no, everyone will have to pass through tremendous crisis in order to turn towards God. And these shocks are embedded in the world. The more you are entangled in the world, the more shocks you get. You go on getting shocks and shocks till you turn yourself towards God. Until you turn towards God, you keep on getting shocks. See? You become so miserable, so disgusted, you just want to get away from this kind of restless life, and you really hanker after peace of mind. And that, when hankering comes, God, the all merciful, the all loving, He just takes you up. He provides all the necessary help to save you. And you begin to feel that even the very first step in the spiritual life will make you tremendous joy. And you feel remarkably peaceful. And next comes the practice point of spiritual life. The first is hankering after spiritual life. The second is spiritual sadhana. So, your success in spiritual life depends on the intensity of your sadhana. That means how you would be able to concentrate your mind on the spiritual ideas. That means you have to exert yourself with all your resources at command to apply yourself positively in the spiritual life. And that means you were carrying on the life in one way, now you have to carry on the life in quite opposite way. That's why the struggle comes. Every moment you come across hurdles, obstructions, difficult situations, all these things come up. You'll be teased by the people. You'll be humiliated by the people. And they try to tempt you in so many ways to see that you don't go towards God. World has got its own methods to tempt a person. That is Maya. That is Maya. That is a game. It is a game. It is. World, the activity of the world, the people, how they are conducting themselves, the whole thing is just defined as game. It's a game. That's all. Lila Kshetra. And you have to win in the game. You have to come victorious. You must not be defeated in the game you are playing. And when you are set in that motion, then you will see how God helps you every step. The immediate step is the approach of Guru. The approach of Guru. There are so many categories I said in the beginning. Sri Ramakrishna explains very nicely. He compares to the doctors. Some doctors, you know, they just feel the pulse and make some examination of the patient and just prescribes the medicine and just tells you, please take this, you'll be okay. He doesn't bother about whether that person is taking the medicine or whether he is getting any improvement. He is not just worried about that. Just he prescribes and leaves him. That's one category. The another category, the doctor not only examines the patient, not only prescribes the medicine, but also persuades him to take it. And he convinces him why he should take the medicine. Why? If you don't take the medicine, these are the consequences and you'll be in greater trouble. So please take. So he convinces him in all possible ways so that he can take the medicine. And third category, the doctor knows if the patient does not take the medicine, he will die. So, he knows how to save the patient, but he must see the patient takes the medicine. So, he not only prescribes, not only examines the patient, not only prescribes the medicine, not only convinces him to take the medicine, but forces him to take the medicine. He literally forces, you must take. And he sees that the patient takes the medicine in his front. Just like that, the spiritual masters, and you must be very fortunate to come into contact with a spiritual teacher who is illumined. It is not easy to get such illumined teachers all the time. Once in a while they come. Even if they come, you are not able to recognize them. How many people could recognize? Very, very few. Manushyanam sahasreshu kaschid yatati siddhaye yatatam siddhanam kaschin mam veti tatvataha. Lord Krishna says in the Gita, one among 1,000 really aspire for spiritual life. Even among those who aspire for spiritual life, only 1 or 2 will come to know the real nature of the self. So, anyway, as I said earlier, God provides the teacher. It is God only who is providing everything for us. He is providing air to breathe. He is providing water to drink and nourish ourselves. He provides food. He provides sunlight. He provides everything. Is it not? He is loving the whole universe, the whole creation. He is under the direct supervision of God. People think that we are taking care, we are doing this, we are dancing. The dancing, you are dancing only because of the divine power. If the divine power is withdrawn, you are dancing, you will collapse immediately. It's just like boiling the potato on the pan. You know, as long as the fire is below, as long as the heat is there, it is dancing in the oil. But once the heat is taken up, where is the dancing? Just stops. All the activity in the world will stop if God's attention is withdrawn. So, God is always present. He is everywhere. He is in everyone. He is in every being. It is not a myth. It is a fact. When you realize it, you will get supreme peace. That's why Lord Krishna says in the Gita, don't hate anyone. The reason is, I am dwelling in everybody, Lord Krishna says. If you hurt a person, you are hurting me. So, you have to take these spiritual ideas and build up your life. Vasudeva sutam devam kamsa chanura mardanam devaki paramanandam krishnam vande jagadgurum. The teacher of the universe, the spiritual master of the universe, Lord Krishna, he is giving instructions in the Bhagavad Gita. Is full of spiritual instructions. Take any one instruction, follow it up, your life becomes blessed. Nakankshati, don't desire anything. That means Don't run after the world. Desiring God is not considered as desire. If you stop running after the desires, then the mind is steady enough to think about God. It is the desires that bother you. So what is that bothering? You must remove that botheration. That's a very important step. So, then, as I said, God comes and helps the spiritual aspirants. It is to help them God incarnates. Do you know that? It is to help the spiritual aspirants God incarnates. He takes the form of a human being. The divine power concretizes itself into a specific form and lives amongst us in order to show the spiritual path. Look, this is the way you must go. This is the way you must practice. And here, Sri Ramakrishna, as I said in my prayer, the embodiment of all religions in the world, the Supreme God Incarnate has come just for the love of humanity. How he integrated all the religions, how he stressed upon the practical aspect of religion. Stop talking, do practice. Do practice. Coming to spiritual life, coming to Sri Ramakrishna means you must be practical in implementing the spiritual instructions given by the Master. He wants practical life. Religion is intensely practical life. So, and Sri Ramakrishna has come, and he himself says that I have come in order to show the path to millions of spiritual aspirants. Whoever has uttered God's name at least once, sincerely, they all come to me. Sri Ramakrishna says that. So, one must have tremendous devotion towards the Guru, tremendous reverence towards the teacher, then you will see how you can succeed in your life. And Guru always tries to see how the disciple improves his way of life. He wants to see the progress of the disciple. So he is watchful whether the disciple is following the instructions properly. And if the disciple really follows what the Guru says, if he is sincere, certainly he will meet with success in the life. The teacher, his position is a very difficult one. You know, when the student is learning, he makes mistakes. He makes mistakes. And the teacher will point out, look, this is not the way. You must correct it. You must do like this. So, but when you are being corrected, you must be very sincere in correcting yourself. If you are egoistic, and if you think, he always tries to find out defects in my ways of life, and you feel a kind of hurt feeling. If you have that hurt feeling, then you can't progress in spiritual life. You shouldn't have that. That means your ego is playing important part in your life than the spiritual aspiration. So you should not allow your ego to rise up. You must be very humble. In spiritual life, it is important. The more you are humble, the more you are near to God. And the teacher is your well-wisher. He always wants the disciple to come towards God. And he even leads him, literally, towards God. So, he says, for his own good. So whatever he says, you must be able to follow it up without grumbling, without question. And that is the test of your devotion to the Guru. And the principal Guru is one who initiates you, who gives you a holy mantra in a formal way, and he gives you specific instructions how to follow it up. And he is your prime Guru, the principal Guru on whom your whole spiritual life depends. And there are other subsidiary Upagurus are there. It's all right, but they don't come in the mainstream. The mainstream is one who has initiated into spiritual life, one who has given the holy mantra. You must hold on to that. And you must hold on to your Guru with love and devotion. You should not keep on changing the Gurus. You see, that makes no sense, and you will not be able to do any practice, because every Guru will give you something to you and will ask you to follow something, and you will be confused, and you can very well be in conflict whether to do this, whether to do that. So why should you get into that kind of mess? That means, that's why our tradition says, hold on to one teacher. Sri Ramakrishna says, hold on to one path. Don't stop till you complete that journey. Go on marching. Reach the goal. Then if you got time, then you give attention to other things. Till you reach the goal, don't divert your attention this way, that way. So, in order to maintain the intensity of devotion, you will have to have one Guru and one mantra, which is your life force. Your spiritual life force is that mantra. You have to surrender yourself totally to that. You belong to that and that alone. That's all. But it doesn't mean you should antagonize others. No. Without any antagonization, you love everyone, but your love to chosen deity is special. Sri Ramakrishna gives the example. There is a couple, husband and wife, modest couple, religious minded, devoted. That means the wife loves the husband very sincerely, devotedly, lovingly. In the same way, husband also loves the wife. And husband's relations come, husband's brothers, husband's sisters, and the relations, they sometimes visit their home. When they visit their home, the wife treats them very well, as if they belong to her own. And she treats them lovingly, with all care, with all attention, with all hospitality. It's true. But at the same time, her love towards husband is special.
In the same way, you can love all the gods and goddesses of the world. But your love towards your chosen deity is special. So you must have that kind of attitude. Then there is no question of any conflict. There's another way of maintaining your devotion, that is, see your chosen deity in everyone, whomsoever you see. The tiger is roaming in the forest. See your chosen deity in the tiger. The tiger is, how nice, how beautiful it is roaming. Let it live happily. See, the other day, I had been to Orlando. I was so happy to say this, and I visited the animal kingdom, which is recently started there. I went in a safari. It's a beautiful place, remarkably great. And the elephants, in a majestic way, I saw the elephant, the full stature. How beautiful it is to look into that. And lions, tigers, roaming. Just I was looking at them, witnessing them, how they are happy in their own way. And I saw in one area, there were about 4 tigers were there. There was one tiger which was lying down. Just it was relaxing. At a distance, there was another tiger. It got up for no reason. And it just went near the one which was relaxing. And it began to lick his body. I stood there for a while. What is this? See how God has given this element of love. And you feel joyful. So like that, you must feel good for everyone. Good. It may be tiger. If you go near, it may bite you. It is ferocious, no doubt. But it has got its right to live upon. You should not hurt it. You should not humiliate the animals. Let them live happily. Let them live happily. So, in fact, one of our devotees wanted to give some donation, and he wanted to name the donation as Vivekananda Trust. The purpose is, he's stating, the amount must be utilized for the distress among the people and the animals. When I saw he has added animals, I was so happy to hear that. Poor animals, who will take care of them? That's really, that's the service we should do. Not only caring ourselves, but caring others also. Not only caring your own kith and kin, your own family, there's nothing special in that. You do that anyway. But doing for others, caring for others, is remarkably great. Remarkably great. I give one example. In my Purvashram, before I enter into spiritual life, in our family, I used to observe, of course, the family was in a very orthodox tradition, and I used to see students coming there every week. Some days were fixed. Wednesday, about 2-3 students will come. Friday, 2-3 students will come. Saturday, 2-3 students will come. Like that. What? Just they come and they take food, lunch or dinner along with us. And they go, and I asked the parents, what is this matter? Who are these students coming? And they were saying, see, they are all trying to learn. They are going to schools, but they don't have facility for eating. So we are providing them. It's a great help for them, if we can do that. That is remarkable. So giving, the act of giving, is remarkable in this modern age. Give. Earning is one thing. Many people earn. What does it matter? But give, many people may not give. Many billionaires are there, but how many really spend the money on charitable purposes, on a good cause? There are people, no doubt. The idea is, you must develop. Swamiji says, Sri Ramakrishna says, in Kali Yuga, the charity is the biggest tapas. Charity. The more you give, the more you get. Don't expect anything, everything will come to you. Expect something, nothing will come to you. That's the secret. And that secret is proved in my case at least. If I want nothing, everything will come to me. If I expect something, it won't come. It's a beauty, it's a love, actually. And so, if you have this approach, then everything becomes lovable. Even difficulties, you love them. Oh, difficulties come to strengthen you. It strengthens your nerves. You need to become strong. That means, so to strengthen your mind, to strengthen your limbs, to strengthen your body, to strengthen your system, things do happen. So have this positive approach, then you are not afraid of anything. Not to be afraid of anything is a spiritual quality. Abhayam sattva samshuddhihi. Lord Krishna says in the Bhagavad Gita, abhayam, fearlessness. The more you are in spiritual life, the more you are spiritual, the more spiritual life you are living means you are fearless, more and more fearless. Because your real nature is strength itself. Fear is because of the delusion. People are devoured by the demon of illusions. So, Guru plays a very, very important role, and one has to follow the Guru. And Guru allows sometimes the disciples to serve him. The act of serving is not easy, though it looks easy. Because serving Guru is something special. It has got spiritual significance. And if a person devotedly serves the Guru, he gets success in spiritual life very easily. But then one has to be very careful in serving the Guru, and that is very important. And we have got many instances where the Guru's grace flows abundantly on the disciples, and how the disciples are uplifted in that process. I take the incidents from the life of Shankaracharya, a very great illumined soul. His masterpiece is Viveka Chudamani, a very famous text. And Shankaracharya has given the message of Vedanta. He is Paramajnani, the man of supreme knowledge, Paramabhakta, man of supreme devotion. So the integration of Jnana and Bhakti you can see in Acharya Shankar. Very, very, very great. And how Guru's grace falls upon the disciple, that's very significant and it's very interesting.
There was a devoted family. After a long time, they got a boy. A boy was born to them. They were very happy. But what happened was, the boy was not sleeping. He was not speaking. He was dumb. And he was not active. He was not showing any interest in learning. Though the father was well versed in the Vedas, and the father became very much depressed. Why am I having this boy with this way of behaving? He doesn't speak out, he doesn't show any inclination to learning, he behaves like idiot. What's to be done? He was terribly pained. But anyway, he was a very devoted person. It so happened, Shankaracharya came to that place. And immediately somebody suggested to this parent, why not you take this boy to Acharya Shankar? Maybe by his grace, the boy may be saved. And immediately the boy was taken there, and Shankaracharya saw that boy. The boy looked very pretty, and he recognized the purity of the boy, and he touched his head. The grace flowed from Shankaracharya on this boy. Just he touched his head. Then he asked, who are you? Why are you behaving in this way? All that time the boy was not speaking. Immediately the boy began to speak. He is quoting the verses, Vedic verses, and he's praising Acharya Shankar, and he's speaking about the Vedanta. And the parents were amazed. What has happened? They thought the boy was idiot and stupid, but now he seems to be very learned. All these things could happen. He had that quality of purity, and Shankaracharya recognized it and blessed him. So, by the blessings of Shankara, he became really great. And, you know, he became one of his principal disciples. Sri Shankaracharya had got 4 principal disciples. He is the Hastamalaka, his name. And then, he was very much pleased, and this disciple played a very important role later on in the mission of Shankaracharya. And you know, Shankaracharya established 4 mutts. One is in Shringeri in Karnataka, another is in Dwarka, that is Sharda Mutt, it's called. And in everywhere he established a particular Veda. And here, where Hastamalaka was made the head of the center, Samveda was very prominent. Anyway, there is another incident. How another disciple also was very much blessed by Shankara. Acharya Shankara was taking classes for the disciples, for these 4 or 5 disciples were there. He was teaching Upanishads. On that particular day, Shankaracharya was waiting for the disciple to come. All the others were there. One more disciple was to come. He had not yet come, but Shankaracharya waited for a while. Because at that moment, that disciple was washing the clothes of the Guru. Shankaracharya was the Guru. He was washing the clothes. He had not completed it. He was just about to complete it. In a minute he would come. But the other disciples were very restless, and they thought they are very wise, and they thought that boy who was serving is not so intelligent as they were. So they began to, in a way, they wanted the class to start. Why should we wait for the boy? Let him come. Afterwards he will join. So they began to chant the beginning Vedic prayers. That's the tradition. When before the class, the prayer is done. And they began to chant the prayers. And Shankaracharya was silently observing. And he noticed the egoism in those disciples. He wanted to correct them. Do you know what he did? He raised his hand in the direction of the disciple who was washing his clothes. He blessed him. He raised his hand, blessed him. The moment he came, he began to quote all the Sanskrit verses which they were discussing in the class. And he began to give commentaries. The Guru, because he was very devoted in serving the Guru, and Guru blessed him. So Guru's blessings may come any time, in any manner. Be open-hearted. Be always ready to receive the Guru's grace. That's the point. And he also became one of the principal disciples. One is Hastamalaka. This one is Totakacharya. He established Math in the North India. And he became very important Swami there. Then the third one is another disciple. I'm discussing about the four disciples, principal disciples, how each one was great, how each one received the grace of Guru, how they were closely associated with Shankaracharya. One day, Shankaracharya wanted to test the disciples in order to know the worth of them. So he immediately called. He gave a call. Come and meet me quickly. That was the call. But at that moment, the disciples were all standing across the Ganges. They can't immediately cross. They have to take a boat and come. It takes a little time, no doubt. But Swamiji is calling, come quickly. So one of them, he did not search for boat. The others were searching for the boat. This fellow simply jumped into the river. His mind was totally fixed on the Guru. He is calling me. Let me go immediately. So he jumped into the river and he began to walk as fast as he could. His whole attention was on Guru. And what happened was, every step he was putting in the water under the, he was placing his foot on the lotus. So he was walking on the lotus and crossed the ocean, Ganga, to reach the Guru. And so his name has become Padma Pada. Padma means lotus. Because of his intense devotion to Guru, he was not drowned by Ganga. On the other hand, he was supported by the lotuses when he walked through the Ganga. See how Shankaracharya blesses and shows his grace. and he made him the head of the Govardhan Mutt in Puri. And another important disciple, he also, how he got the blessings of Shankara. His name is Sureshwaracharya, who became the head of the Shringeri Mutt, Shankar Mutt in Karnataka. Sureshwaracharya, he is also very great. He was a householder, but very well versed in the scriptures, very good in rituals, very strict in performing all the duties. And Shankaracharya came to his place. See, Guru coming to the place of a person who would become disciple later on, it's amazing. But God's ways are like that. You don't know how God's grace comes, in what manner it comes. Well, Shankaracharya wanted to have a debate with this person because he was a very well-known, renowned person of that time. So he wanted to impart the knowledge of Vedanta. The debate was done, and finally Mandan Mishra had to yield to what Shankara has established. And according to the agreement of the debate, whoever is defeated must take the path of the person who has won. Shankaracharya was a monk, and this person, his name was Mandana Mishra. He was a householder, but according to the agreement, he has to renounce the householder life. He has to become a monk because he was defeated in the debate. And those were the days they would follow. They were very truthful. Very, very truthful. That is very basic quality important in spiritual life. And so he renounced. He became the disciple of Shankaracharya. His name is Sureshwaracharya. So, well, how God's grace flows like that, and they become very great later on, and God's glory is realized once you live a spiritual life in a proper way. So there are basics in our Vedic traditions which I wanted to tell you in order to receive God's grace, in order to receive Guru's grace. The first thing is Satyam Vada, tell the truth. Dharman Chara, follow righteousness. Swadhyaya Pravachanabhyam Na Pramaditavyam, don't give up studying spiritual texts. Don't give up studying spiritual texts. These three are the basics. If these three are practiced properly, then you are ready for getting spiritual knowledge. You must not compromise on these things. Oh, I have to be in the world, I have to lie, I have to steal. Don't talk all such things. If you are stealing, if you are cunning, if you are lying, even though spiritual ideas are there, it won't have any effect upon you. So you have to format your life nicely, and then all help will come. So I was telling you how the Guru helps the disciple and how he corrects it. In Sri Ramakrishna's life, there is an instance. Once, you know, the Sri Ramakrishna's guru was Totapuri, who initiated Sri Ramakrishna into Advaita, the non-dualism, the all-pervading universal consciousness, to realize that. So he initiated him, and Sri Ramakrishna got illumination in 3 days, and Tothapuri was surprised. He took 40 years to realize the truth, and Sri Ramakrishna got it in 3 days. Anyway, Sri Ramakrishna's constitution was such, anything he would practice, in 3 days he would get the success. And he says, all the success is because of Mother's grace. Mother was everything to Sri Ramakrishna. Divine Mother, he is father, mother, guru, everything. That's why we call Sachidananda Guru is God himself. And then, after everything is over, they were talking together. And Tothapuri was sitting in front of a dhuni, that is a fire. Tothapuri was a Naga saint. According to Naga tradition, they will have always fire in the front. The fire is very sacred for them. It is very sacred. And they were debating, they were talking about some spiritual ideas about Brahman. At that time, what happened was a gardener suddenly came and took some of the burning cinders there in order to light up his tobacco pipe. He was smoking. He came and just took it up immediately. And Tothapuri was talking to Sri Ramakrishna. Immediately he found out somebody came and touched the fire. He became very angry. Tothapuri became very angry and began to shout at him. He began to abuse him. He even frightened him. Seeing that, Sri Ramakrishna laughed, wild laughing. He began to laugh. And Tothapuri was shocked. Why Sri Ramakrishna is laughing? Then he asked him, why are you laughing? Why are you laughing so loudly? And Sri Ramakrishna said, I am laughing because of your action. Because of your temper. Just now we were talking about Brahman and God is everywhere in every being and so on. And how is it you are showing so much anger towards that being, towards that man? A poor fellow in whom God also is living. I was just thinking about it, I am smiling. And Sri Ramakrishna gave me a suggestion. It is not good to have temper that way. A spiritual person shouldn't have. And he realized, Tothapuri realized that, and he says to Sri Ramakrishna, well, from today, from this moment, I will not be angry anymore. See how Sri Ramakrishna became the guru of the guru. Because he was incarnation, he came to help the spiritual aspirants, and he knew Tothapuri was a great man, was a great saint, but he had some little bit of weakness that he removed it. So Guru's grace is like that. It flows, and it flows immensely. So one has to have that strong desire. And without Guru's grace, you can't expect spiritual progress. And sometimes what happens is that one doesn't take seriously what the guru was instructing, and they won't feel any improvement in their life. But if a person is really devoted and sincere, then really Guru's grace flows upon him, and he'll be able to go forward in the spiritual path. And there's another instance when Sri Ramakrishna, after visiting a devotee, wanted to return to Dakshineshwar temple. It was quite dark in the night,
There was no light, no electricity in the time of Sri Ramakrishna. They had to carry lantern. At that moment, there was no lantern also. So how to walk? So he was just thinking about, then there was a person, a devotee, who immediately said to Sri Ramakrishna, "Master, see, you can go, you can see the light now." Then he raised his armpit. And from that, a beacon of light, reaching up to the Dakshineshwara temple, "Swami, you can walk now, clearly." And Sri Ramakrishna, no doubt appreciated it, but then he said, "Look, it's not good to exhibit the power like this, because it will obstruct your spiritual onward journey. You will be stuck up with this power. You will not go forward." So there was another disciple who developed by his spiritual practices, he developed a special type of power by which he would become invisible. It is a spiritual power. And Sri Ramakrishna said, "It is dangerous. It is not good for you." But then he had that power. So what happened? On account of that, he fell into worldly ways. He fell into love with some girl of a rich man's family, and he would visit them because she was not seen by anybody. And Sri Ramakrishna tells, in order to save them, Sri Ramakrishna is telling, in order to save these two disciples, he withdrew those powers. From that time onwards, there was no botheration for them because they had lost that power. So they concentrated fully upon further spiritual progress. And so things are like that. Devotion to Guru is vital, and Guru's grace definitely flows on the disciple. Guru's disciple relationship is very important, and your life will be totally secured when you have the real Guru on your side. With these words, I conclude my talk. Thank you very much.
Om Sahana Vavatu, Sahanau Bhunakto, Sahaviryam Karavavahai, Tejasvinavadhitamastu Ma Vidvishavahai. Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi, Harihi Om. May the Divine Spirit protect us, guide us, give us strength and right understanding. May we not hate one another. May love and harmony be with us all. Peace, peace, peace be unto all.
May the Divine Lord protect us. May He nourish us. May we work in harmony with great vigor. May our study be illuminating and fruitful. May we not hate each other. Peace, peace, peace be unto all.